This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
Hey, welcome to the Maggie Dawn Show. Maggie's out today, obviously. She'll be back on Monday. I'm Matt Rothschild, and I'm the co-guest host today with Angela Lang of Block. And you're listening to Civic Media Radio Network all across the great state of Wisconsin and on the World Wide Web at civicmedia.us. And now I'm pleased, really pleased, to have an old friend of mine who is a Republican, an ex-Republican official, and in fact, the former governor of Wisconsin, the one and only Scott McCallum, on the show. Scott, welcome to the program.
Well, Matt, thank you. And, you know, you could have made a little bit different introduction by not putting such an emphasis on the old friend.
Well, we're all getting old. And, you know, one of the things that I admire about you is when Scott Walker and Robin Voss were trying to gut the power of Governor-elect Evers, you were the only Republican that I heard who said boo about it, who made any critical noise about it, and you were up front saying that's the wrong thing to do. And I thought that took a lot of courage, and you were right on the merits, so I was grateful for that. Listen, I want you to, you're with a new organization called the Wisconsin Alliance for Civic Trust. You're one of the co-leaders with David Haynes, who's I used to work with. He is the former editorial page editor over at the Journal Sentinel. I wasn't there. I was trying to get my pieces in the Journal Sentinel. And so I contacted David Haynes. Angela, I'm sure you were doing the same thing. Get my op-ed in there, David. Anyway, tell us about this new organization you're involved with, Scott.
Well, it's new to the state of Wisconsin, Matt. It exists in six states totally. The goal is to make sure that we have democracy and the institutions in a democracy remain strong. And it's interesting with your introduction on the powers, because we're seeing a constant attacks on institutions in a democracy. And I've long thought that institutions make up what a society is, and they're important to a democracy. Institutions such as police force, military, judiciary, and as we're looking at the dance taking place in Washington now, it's also important to have an independent branch of Congress. So we'll see how all of this plays out. But in particular, we focused, as did the other five states, on making sure we had safe, secure, and trusted elections. Another important institution, obviously, to a democracy. And given what we've seen, many of the different things that have occurred during the course of very close elections, we wanted to make sure they were monitored, and even further, that there was trust in what was going on in the system.
And there was so much coming from Trump and his deputies over the last many years to try to corrode the public confidence and the trust in our elections you know, it's been an uphill battle here in Wisconsin. You know, we saw a lot of that going on here. We saw a reminder of it with Eric Hovde in his very tardy decision to concede the election. And while he was going out the door, he was casting doubt on the legitimacy of the counting in Milwaukee. I mean, that is not good for democracy, is it?
Matt, it's always a pleasure with you when you revert. You revert to the natural you of the partisanship, and I will revert to wanting to have people get along, which is part of what we're doing, is trying to create an understanding. And I understand it from the media perspective and from fundraising and the politics, and when you run for office, how you have to go to the edges.
But it's not just partisan. I mean, they were. I mean,
yeah, Trump, yeah. But let me conclude. Our focus.
Sure.
Is 80% of the public, and this includes in Wisconsin, agrees on most issues. And so what we've seen, and we did a series of hearings around the state, more like focus groups around the state. And it's interesting how there's a tendency towards violence, a concern of what's happening in local politics, and local politicians becoming very concerned that the spillover is occurring from federal office. As we were told in several of the areas from local officials, they say, you know, in our area, people don't care about these national, we want our roads fixed, we want to fix the pothole, we want the schools to, that's what we care about. Why do we have to start taking positions for funding or have a party work for or against us? They don't want to see that. They'd rather have them as nonpartisan. So that's what we're trying to get back to, is understanding we agree, but we can civilly disagree. And so when we say civilly disagree, you know, if I were strictly political, I mean, I can say, yes, I agree with you those in those areas. I can also say Abrams and a number of other races and what's occurred between the Gore and Bush race. I mean, this has gone on for some time. Do we agree with it? Well, let's fix up the problems that have been occurring. And we know there have been issues, including in Wisconsin in the past. And let's create a trust. Let's have the monitoring, and let's have an openness. And I thought we did see that, by the way, in Wisconsin this time when we had the issue, and, you know, it could have been a big issue in Madison with two ballots being sent out with the absentee requests. But there was very much a transparency. Yes, it was a mistake. Yes, it's being fixed. Here's what it is. And that's what people expect. There's going to be human error, but the system itself. Now, there are going to be issues that we didn't get involved in with our organization, nor will we. And those are political issues on what actual political issues that take votes and should be taken up in the legislature.
And you're not, your organization, Wisconsin Alliance for Civic Trust, doesn't do that?
No, we're entirely staying out of issues. We're a cross-partisan.
And yeah, I see that.
But I will tell you, even, I mean, you can see from the website, right, which is wisact.org, the honorary chairs, former members of the Supreme Court, you know, Democrat governor. Got, as you mentioned, David Haynes and I, David Haynes. And as much as you tried to get into me, I kind of kid him, because when he did write about me, I said, see, I knew you were a Democrat all along. and his response, Scott, I was editorial opinion page. I'm supposed to give my opinion. but it's, you know, we're trying to become, and the organization itself is cross-partisan, split pretty much evenly on the steering committee, regional directors throughout the state. In fact, I find it very interesting because we try to create a balance. But many people say, I don't even want to be identified as a party. I just want to help. I support democracy. I support what you're trying to create. I support our institutions. Let me just be on for that reason, not as a partisan.
We're speaking with former Governor Scott McCallum, who is one of the leaders of this new organization, Wisconsin Alliance for Civic Trust. I mean, I'm all about, you know me, I'm all about talking civilly, even with people who disagree with me. And here at the Civic Media Radio Network, we're trying to foster that kind of dialogue as well. It's hard, though, sometimes. I mean, it's hard.
And you know what, Matt? It goes back to the first introduction of an old friend. And I was just sharing with somebody how when you get to be friends with people, you can have this. It's like in college, when we were in college, as you know, we could have debates. We could argue. We didn't know where we were coming from. And it was a lot of fun doing that, and you learn from it. But we've gotten to the point where people take it very personally and identify with their tribe, as opposed to trying to listen and understand what the other side is saying and maybe agreeing in some of the points. By the way, and you may not like what I'm going to say, but I thought it was one of the things that J.D. Vance did that was masterful in the debate. You know, it started out with an attack, and Vance responded, but also said, I agree, and here's why, on some of these things. And, you know, you saw the conclusions. The media, you know, it was a friendly thing. It may have been people from the Midwest, what it is, or it was boring. But I found it personally informative and interesting on the issues and let people make up their own minds. But yeah, we can agree on some of these things.
Well, I thought, just, you know, I had a different take on it. I thought, well, Walls.
I would have guessed that.
Yeah, Walls got the crap beat out of him on that and didn't recognize that he was being played when he was being complimented. You know, he was being complimented, Walls was, by Vance. But Vance had a knife in his hand, and he was stabbing Kamala Harris in the back in the very next sentence, and that left Walls just, you know, bleeding and flat-footed there on the canvas. So, you know, it did come across, though, if you were just kind of a looking at it casually, well, these guys are getting along. Isn't it nice we can have civic dialogue? And I do believe that we need more civic dialogue, but that, I thought, was just a tactical move by the vice president-elect here.
Yeah.
What do you make, you know, Scott? Go ahead. You go ahead.
You're the guy in charge. I'm just on your program. I was gonna say, you know, it doesn't mean we don't disagree on some issues, but even on some very extreme issues that are taking place, there's agreement. I mean, Matt, I teach at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee in graduate school courses. And just going through some of these things of finding agreement. And I used an example of immigration. I mean, there's an issue that's really split in this country. But the fact is, really, most people probably agree. We've got a system that's not at work. We want people to come into the country. It's what our country was made of. I mean, we all come from immigrant families, some of us more recently off the boat than others. But the McCallum family, by the way, is just a couple of generations back. There are areas of agreement. And that used to be an art in politics, of finding areas where we can agree and move society forward. Now the art is how much money you can raise by demonizing the opposition.
Certainly money in politics is a huge issue. Citizens United was a horrible decision. You know, I spent a lot of my life fighting for overturning Citizens United and getting public financing and getting money out of politics. That's going to be a hard nut to crack, but it's an important nut to crack. We got to keep that front and center too. I do want to get more of your ideas, Governor McCallum, on how we can foster a civic dialogue here when we come back from this short break. And I'm going to let my co-host Angela Lang get into the conversation as well. I really appreciate Governor McCallum being with us here on the Maggie Dawn Show, and we'll be right back.
You're listening to Civic Media. Stay up to date on the latest news and information for your local community and Wisconsin by signing up for our free email newsletter. Visit civicmedia.us/email to get started.
With you here on the Maggie Dawn Show. Maggie's off today. She'll be back on Monday. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network all across the state of Wisconsin and on the web at civicmedia.us. Delighted to have Scott McCallum, the former governor of Wisconsin, on the show. He currently teaches at UW-Milwaukee at the Bader Institute of Nonprofit Management, and he's one of the leaders of this new organization we've been talking about, Wisconsin Alliance for Civic Trust. My guest co-host, as usual, is Angela Lang from BLOC. That's Black Leaders Organizing for Communities. And Angela, I'm going to let you take over from here for a little bit and ask Scott whatever's on your mind.
Yeah. First of all, thanks, Governor, for being here. And I think it's so important that folks all across, you know, party lines or wherever people fall on the political spectrum are having these types of conversations. You know, I'm thinking, you know, as an organizer, there was a lot to be concerned about ahead of the election. One being, you know, if say Kamala Harris were to win, would there be another, say, January 6th type of situation? But then a lot of us were also thinking, well, if, you know, Trump does win, are there going to be challenges and more erosion of our democracy and civil liberties? And so I think now that we're past the election phase of it, and now folks are kind of in the how do we respond and protect our very fragile democracy? I'm wondering about how you all are thinking about this next phase. And then also specifically, if possible, like there's, you know, the national democracy on a federal level, but also how are you all making sure that some of that doesn't kind of trickle into Wisconsin as well, too?
Yeah, those are really good questions. And we could spend a lot of time on those, those alone. First of all, we tend to look at things politically. I'm very proud and very pleased that some of our partners listed right on our website are the Wisconsin Council of Churches, the Wisconsin Academy of Arts, Letters, and Sciences in Wisconsin. These aren't thought of as political organizations. They may have leanings one way or another, but they're looking to improve society and to help society. So for me, breaking out of that partisanship was a good sign. To get directly to your question of the concern, we were concerned, as with the other states, and you can see it from the tracking of the social media. We're concerned from the conservative side, it had Trump lost in a very close race. And we were concerned with the left, had he won in a close race. So from many perspectives, it took a lot of pressure off having it the size of the victory was. I think there was a lot of involvement, a number of civic organizations involved in monitoring elections. There should be no doubt. It's an interesting thing we saw from our focus groups, by the way, around the state. Mm-hmm. It came out, yes, there's a concern. The conservatives, what's happening? Is our elections fair? Well, we think they are here. You know, in Eau Claire, you know, we trust everybody here. We work together. You know, we're Democrat, Republican, but we don't care. We work together. But gosh, what about Green Bay? And you get to Green Bay, well, we know people here. We work hard on it. We work together. But Milwaukee, you know, mm-hmm. So it's kind of, and you think of Wisconsin. Well, Wisconsin, it's pretty tough to be corrupt in Wisconsin. On election day, 1/6 of all election workers are in the state of Wisconsin. Hmm. It's not run by one or two people. Mm-hmm. It's all localized. So it's an interesting system in that respect, but a lot of input and a lot of people involved, which is, it's the essence of a democracy to have that many people involved.
What would you say to folks, speaking of folks that are involved, whether they're thinking about being involved or they don't know how to get involved, folks that are like maybe seriously concerned about our civil liberties and, you know, whether it's they have a trans kid or, you know, they're worried about the curriculum and banning books and, you know, things like that. What would you say to folks to kind of comfort them? Understanding that, yes, we have these democratic guardrails and things seem very fragile and hanging on very much by a thread right now. What would you say to comfort folks about the state of our democracy looking forward?
Well, so just to say one point, there are many others as well who felt that fragile thread had been there and may be saved now. So I'm just wanted to lay that out, that there are different perspectives of this. It's disconcerting. And I would hear this quite a bit of, I just don't even want to get involved. It's gotten so bad. It's so toxic. It's, what was the joke that came out this week? If you don't want to have to get Christmas presents for all your relatives, go home for Thanksgiving and start talking politics. I think I came off the campus. That's part of what we're trying to do, is be able to get people to talk with each other, understand viewpoints, and to reduce the toxicity. But directly to your question is, the sure way to lose a democracy is to not be involved. It's the number of people that were election monitors and poll watchers and working the poll is very gratifying. And I've had people, a lot of different positions, and I'm sure you, because you're obviously have your finger to the pulse of society, hearing these types of things. But it's very disconcerting. I had somebody say, "Look, I'm going ghost. I'm gray. You know, I'm kind of disappearing." Well, no, you're a leader in the community. Well, no, I don't want to get involved in this stuff. You know, it's and that's sad. We should be able to, and that's, by the way, one of the things we want to do for a next step, work with clergy and with other people, civic leaders, and have people of different political persuasions sit down and talk with each other and just have discussions and start on. We did trainings around the state pertaining to that. The first stage, we tried to publicly show what the process was and how people should get involved. The second part was to listen to people, but then the third part was in having the training of what do we do with these type of questions, exactly what you brought up, issues of abortion, these things, and how we can get away from that.
Scott, we got to wrap it up. That's former Governor Scott McCallum. You're listening to the Maggie Dawn Show, we'll be right back with Angela Lang.
Thanks.
Come on, get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. heroicdeed.com.
Hey, Matt Rothschild here. Welcome back to the Maggie Dawn Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Angela Lang of Block and I are your guest hosts for this last half hour of the Maggie Dawn Show on the Civic Media Radio Network, which you can get online at civicmedia.us. It was fun for me to have Scott McCallum on the show. I've always found, I used to play basketball with him for 25 years at noontime, even when he was governor. I think his staff didn't like it. He was taking a break all the time at noon, didn't do lunches, wanted to exercise. And he was a great basketball player, much better than I was. But, you know, he always had kind of a moderate sensibility. He wasn't one of these, you know, flamethrowers, let's destroy everything. I'm impressed that he's joined this organization that wants to defend a democracy, Wisconsin Alliance for Civic Trust. The website for that is wisact.org. So that was kind of fun.
I hope it's an opportunity for other folks can see that, like, this issue can be bipartisan. And as he said, just, like, listen to each other, right? And, like, yes, there's a lot of folks that have strong feelings, but I also think, you know, they're leading by example by bringing folks from both sides of the aisle, and hopefully that gets people thinking too.
Yeah, it's quite an impressive list of people who are on their board and their advisors and all that. Mm-hmm. So wisact.org is a good place to go. And now I've got another friend who's joining us by phone. His name is Steve Bauer. He's the vice chair of the Jefferson County Dems. He's one of the most, let's put it this way, he's a practitioner of deep canvassing. And the Jefferson County Dems, one of the most active county branches in the entire state, doing a lot at the grassroots, day in and day out with their clipboards going door to door. It's quite an amazing enterprise they've got going out in Jefferson County. So, Steve, welcome to the show.
Hey, thank you very much, man. I'm glad to be here.
I wanted, you know, you and I were talking offline just personally a couple days ago, and I wanted to hold off on part of the conversation so we could get it fresh here.
Sure.
First off, I'm here with Angela Lang, also a great organizer in Wisconsin here. And hey, I just wanted to know how you make sense of what happened on November 5th, Steve.
Well, you know, it bamboozles me, to be perfectly honest with you. But that said, early on in the deep canvassing, and we started in May and we were at it for 6 months, there were a lot of people that were telling me at the doors, it's about the economy. It is about making ends meet and gas prices and the prices of eggs and all this other stuff. I mean, people would talk about that. And it was no mystery to anybody that was out there at the doors. People were hurting. And I think, honestly, I don't think the Democrats really listened to that the way they should have.
Yeah, I think you're getting at something really important. I think Kamala Harris was in a tough position. She didn't want to divorce herself from Joe Biden's economic policies. That clip of her praising Bidenomics was a killer, because even though at the macro level, Biden and Harris had done a great job in making sure we weren't crashing like other economies were around the world, but for people whose rent was going up, people whose car insurance was going up, people whose grocery bills are going up, it just was slim solace. So I get that you were hearing that at the door. I've used the expression, you just used it, deep canvassing. I'm sure a lot of our listeners don't know what deep canvassing is. Can you give us a definition, Steve?
Absolutely, yeah. Well, deep canvassing is a specialized form of voter engagement that focuses on establishing rapport with voters, prioritizing active listening, and creating a safe space for more meaningful conversations. And it's the only scientifically proven method to influence constituents by using empathetic understanding to bridge gaps in the politically charged atmosphere in which we find ourselves. And I can, you know, certainly go into a lot more detail if you would like.
Well, I want to hear from Angela, because you do deep canvassing too, Angela, don't you?
Yeah. So I was going to say, Steve, you're speaking my language as an organizer. You said all the things, right? Building relationships, listening. And I'm curious, too, because I personally see the value in deep canvassing and doing that active listening and taking that empathetic type of approach in conversations. But not everybody does, because I think we're in this, you know, very constant, urgent cycle of we have to hit as many doors as possible to hit as many people as possible. So thus, you know, people, I think, prioritize quantity over quality sometimes. So I'm curious of how you all made the decision to kind of take it a step further, slow it down a little bit, but also do the deep canvassing. Because I think you really made the case for why it's valuable, but not everyone does it because, like I said, there's limited time, limited resources. So I'm curious of why you all chose to do that. And maybe what are some of the results that you've seen over traditional canvassing?
You bet. Yeah. Well, it was a slow process, but we got our first introduction through Dave Flesher, who was an organizer in Los Angeles. And my wife and I, Leslie, went into Milwaukee, and he started this whole process. And then in Los Angeles about, oh, golly, in the, you know, like 15 years ago. And we went out and we started our deep canvassing in Milwaukee at that point in time. But, you know, the process has been slow, and it was something that we really built on over the years. And the reason we rolled it out here in Jefferson County is because it makes a lot of sense. Dave Flesher talked about 10%. This makes a difference of 10% in the voting that people are likely to do. And there's nothing else that even comes close to that. You know, phone banking or sending postcards or just the regular canvassing, which often starts a conversation with just a simple candidate or issue identification question, or deep canvassing conversations often revolve around an open-ended question that lead to more complex and nuanced conversations. And Angela, you know, and Angela, you said, you know, we oftentimes get out there and it's let's get as many doors knocked as we possibly can, but we're not really talking to the people and we don't really engage with them. And one more thing that I would like to say is that when Dave Flesher did this, he said that a deep canvas conversation, when you really probe somebody and then they tell you their story, it sticks with them for 9 months, as opposed to TV commercials or radio spots or, you know, how many postcards did we get this year? Most of that just goes in the garbage, or a TV commercial may last for 3 days. So a conversation that we have at the doors is really meaningful for voters long term.
And to follow up on Angela's question, have you seen positive results from it, Steve?
Well, as a matter of fact, I did some analysis in Jefferson County of the wards that we knocked on. And let's see, there were 10 wards in the different cities, Johnson Creek and Fort Atkinson and Lake Mills, Waterloo and Watertown. And there were 5 of those wards showed a 1-point increase comparing Biden to Harris. One of them was even, and then 4 of them showed a 1-point decrease from Harris to Biden. And so, you know, as far as seeing some positive results, it seems like it, but there's a lot more analysis that's going to get done by some UW professors. And, you know, we're going to be taking a look at that, those results in a little while. But you compare that to the national average. Voters moved away from Biden by about 7 points around the country. And if you look at the battleground states, that difference was about 4.5 points. In Wisconsin, it was 1.5 points. And I'm seeing in Jefferson County, it might have been a toss-up. But we don't know specifically yet.
And you do this deep canvassing over and over again. You just don't see the person one time and forget about the person, correct? And you don't do it just in the 2 weeks or 2 months before an election. Isn't that right, Steve Bauer?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. We started the whole deep canvassing in May this year. So we were out on the streets for 6 months, and we deep canvassed all of the communities in Jefferson County. We had hundreds of volunteers, literally hundreds of people going out knocking on doors. There was a group of individuals from Indivisible Chicago that came up in July and August and September and October, and we would always pair volunteers with Jefferson County with those people, and we'd go out and knock on doors. And then, on August 25th, there were a group of people from California that flew in. They were associated with a Buddhist election retreat, and they were out with us on the 26th and the 27th. 6 of them went to Milwaukee. 6 of them stayed here in Jefferson County, and we canvassed right through the election. And all in all, from May until, November, we had 72 canvasses, and we knocked on over 10,000 doors. And assuming that's a conservative number of 4 canvassers per event, during these special events when we'd go out, you know, there were 25 to 30 doors per canvas. And given the 72 canvassers and maybe 72 canvasses and 4 to 6 canvassers, we had 1,100 conversations, and then we add the 300 with the Chicago people and the 200 with the Buddhists. We had over 1,600 conversations. Matt, going back to your original question. Go ahead, please.
That's a lot of context, Steve. Let me just jump in and ask this. I'm sure there are listeners here who are saying, you know, I don't want to go knock on people's doors, especially in this hyper-partisan climate we're in. You know, this person's going to shoot me or something. I mean, how do you get over that initial fear that people might have?
That question, we always sent people out in pairs, unless, of course, you were real seasoned and you said, look, I'm just going to go out by myself. And I would do that a lot. And there are other people that would go out by themselves. But it was always during the daytime, and the doors that we knocked were chosen by the DPW, and they were people that sometimes don't vote, leaning Dems. Occasionally we'd have conversations with Republicans, but most of the time, almost every single conversation we had with a Republican was congenial, was thank you very much for your time, and we walked away. And we'd always thank them for the time. But there was only one time that I personally was threatened, and I think I was the only one in the whole group.
What happened then?
Well, I was in Watertown, and I'm standing next to a house where, and it was on 8th Street in Watertown. I mean, it's a typical street. And I'm standing next to my car waiting for my partner to come back, and this woman slides her kitchen door open, her kitchen window open, and she says, "Who are you?" And I told her, "My name is Steve. I'm a volunteer with the Democratic Party of Jefferson County." And she said, "What are you doing?" And I said, "Well, we're knocking on doors and we're having conversations with people." And her response was, "You know, this is a dangerous neighborhood." And I'm looking around and it's no different than any other neighborhood in Fort Atkinson or Jefferson or Lake Mills. And I said, "Well, no, I'm not entirely sure of that." And then she asked, "Are you carrying?" And I said, and I laughed and I said, "No, I'm not carrying." And then she said, "You know, we have the right to carry firearms." And I said, "Yeah, I understand that. You know, I own a 22 and a shotgun for, you know, that I bought, you know, as a teenager, but I didn't tell her that." And then she said, "Well, I don't care what you do. Just don't leave any of your effing stuff on my door."
That's Steve Bauer. Steve, we've got to cut you off right now, but hang on. We'll be right back after the break. You're listening to the Maggie Dawn Show.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
Hey, welcome back to the Maggie Dawn Show. Maggie will be back on Monday. I'm Matt Rothschild, subbing in here for Maggie with my guest host, Angela Lang. You're listening to Civic Media Radio Network. Happy to take your calls here in the last 8 minutes or so of the show. It's 855-752-4842. That's 855-75-CIVIC. We'll get back to our conversation with Steve Bauer in a second, but Jake has been patiently holding online. That's Jake from Racine. Jake, what's on your mind?
Hello. Comment and questions for Mr. McCallum. And, I really have nothing wrong with the peace and love nonpartisan approach and bringing people together that way. But, you know, a lot of Republicans.
Can't hear you, Jake. We seem to have lost you there for a second.
We're going to try to get him back on the line.
Okay. I mean, this is a real question. How do we talk to people who voted for Trump? Half the state voted for Trump. Half the country voted for Trump. Half plus one.
It's hard.
Yeah.
It's hard, especially those of us that are marginalized. And, you know, I've said this before that it's at some point, I know I'm not there yet, but like folks are going to regret the choice that they made and they're going to see how Trump's policies directly impact them. And how do we organize them? And that's going to be a very difficult conversation, but I think one that we'll ultimately need to have.
We have our caller back too, guys.
All right, Jake, pick up where you left off, please.
Hello. Yes. I wanted to ask Mr. McCallum about people like Charlie Sykes and many Republicans, of course, Liz Cheney, who basically feel the Republican Party is the one that has gone off the track as far as democracy. And they're calling on Republicans, you know, Republicans like Mr. McCallum and those that are in, currently in the office to stand up to the president, the president-elect and the people he surrounds himself with, and to retake the party from the MAGA group. And I wonder why Mr. McCallum has chosen to take a nonpartisan approach instead of work within his party.
Well, Jake from Racine, thanks so much for the call. And I think it's a really wise, perceptive question. Mm-hmm. I don't know the answer to it, and he's not here with us online anymore, so I can't answer for him. I will say, at least he wasn't cheerleading for Donald Trump like his predecessor, Governor Tommy Thompson, was, which I found really disreputable and disgusting.
Yeah.
And just knowing Scott's personality, because I've known him for 25 years, you know, he doesn't usually want to stick his neck out too far. I mean, he did when Walker and Voss were stealing power from Governor Evers. But, you know, he's more... He doesn't see himself as a combatant, really, in the way that Liz Cheney does right now. Anyway, that's my best guess, Jake. But thanks for the call. I do think there is a moral duty for people to denounce Trump if they're in the Republican Party and what Trump is trying to do with our democracy. So I'm right with you there, Jake. If you want to join the conversation, it's 855-752-4842. We've got Steve.
We have Paul from Madison here too, as well.
We do. All right, let's get him on.
Hey, Matt, I just want to quickly ask you, and I think I have my facts right. What about the 15 million, or south of 15 million people that didn't vote and just decided not to, that voted in the last election, Trump versus Biden? I mean, I don't understand what happened there. So, thank you.
Well, thanks for the call. And that is a good question, too. And I think a lot of people will be looking at it. I think Gaza was a problem. I think Gaza was a big problem for young activists on college campuses and in communities around the country. The people with the highest moral conscience were most likely to be the best organizers that we could have, especially of their cohort, but maybe, you know, with their own parents, too. And they just were taken out of the equation. And I think that was a huge problem. The other thing is inflation was hurting everybody. So I think that was another problem, too. Angela, what's your feeling?
Yeah, no, I agree. I think especially looking at some of the numbers on college campuses, I think you start to see the impact of the genocide that's happening. But also, again, you know, there are folks that said, I don't feel that either party is going to do anything for me. And my family is hurting. I'm struggling to get by. And so I think it's a mix of both of those. But I also think, you know, that's a question for like the party, too. And, you know, one of my questions for Steve as well is, you know, what's next? You all did this really great deep canvassing, understanding that there's a lot of folks that didn't come out for whatever reason, or, you know, maybe voted for Trump. And even after the April election, just wondering you all's kind of plans on how to maybe get folks engaged, re-engage them, especially in the downtime that we have, you know, a solid 10 months before the next election in 26.
Steve Bauer, do you have an answer for that one?
Well, you know, a couple things. I attended an Indivisible meeting with many, many thousands of people, and they said that, you know, there is going to be overreach. There's going to be pushback. People are going to say, I didn't vote for that. You know, like, for instance, let's dissolve the Department of Education. You know, and already parents are saying, wait a second, funding for my special needs child is going to evaporate. I didn't vote for that. I think there's going to be a lot of pushback. And the other thing that the Indivisible people said, look, is that we do have to organize locally. And we're starting slowly here in Jefferson County to do that. And there are a lot of people that are like-minded with an eye on the midterm elections. And it's
Steve,
really
we're
going
to have to cut it off there. We're out of time, unfortunately. I do want to thank you for being our guest here. I want to thank the other guests who are on the show. Angela Lang, always great to be with you.
Thanks,
I want to thank Cardi in the booth. Thank Maggie Dawn for letting me sub in here on the Maggie Dawn Show. She'll be back on Monday. Stay tuned for the Dom Salvia Show all across the Civic Media Radio Network.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.